Okay, so I was given the task actually to talk about the optimal adjuvant therapy for biliary cancer as gemcitabine and capecitabine. And I did put a maybe for gemcitabine added to capecitabine, certainly. All right, so let's remember that this ultimately, I mean, we're talking about less than 10,000 patients a year with this type of cancer, and then, you know, less than half present with early stage, and then break that down into four different diseases. And it's almost impossible actually to make sense out of the data from small trials here and there other than just signal-seeking trials. So the overall prognosis is poor. We know the surgery is the foundation of cure in this disease. Relapse rates are high. And then prognostic factors, we know that at least lymph node status and margin status are a major determinant of whether treatment works or not. And adjuvant therapy goals are you want to treat the micrometastatic disease, and that we hope leads to an improved survival. The question, like with pancreas cancer, how much do we care actually about local regional control when actually surgery is meant to do that? So prior to the current art, we didn't have much in terms of understanding how do we treat those patients. In the adjuvant setting, there was a meta-analysis by Knox's group up in Toronto that essentially looked at adjuvant therapy in the treatment of biliary tract cancer. And they looked, essentially, there were two groups that seemed to have a favorable outcome when it comes to adjuvant therapy, and that's the lymph node positive, this one, lymph node positive, and then the R1 resection. So these are the two groups that seem, and that's very important to keep in mind when we look at the next two randomized studies and trying to put that in context. So the meta-analysis did suggest that at least for lymph node positive disease, chemotherapy as an adjuvant approach adds value. The question from at least the meta-analysis is that, is there really an added benefit from radiation in the lymph node positive group? And at least from this meta-analysis, the answer was no. And one, the addition of radiation to chemotherapy may be associated with a benefit in the R1 population, irrespective of disease site, but that's a maybe. And then the addition of radiation to chemotherapy may be associated with a deleterious effect in the R0 population. Remember, they didn't break it down really by sites. It was all biliary tract cancer. But it was intriguing to see that in the R0 population, you may actually do more harm if you add additional local control. The study didn't answer whether single agent versus doublet actually made sense. So as you know, gemcitabine cisplatin is the standard in treating advanced biliary cancer. The French have a love affair with oxaliplatin, and so rather than looking at gemcitabine cisplatin, I made sure that oxaliplatin was the platinum of choice. It was a GemOx versus surveillance study. This was the PRODIGE study, biliary tract cancer, R0, R1 surgery, etc. Anyways, the results of the study came back, unfortunately, negative for the primary endpoint, although there was a trend towards improving outcome, but the p-value was essentially negative. The hazard ratio was 0.83 and a p-value of 0.31. So this was a negative study with a trend towards some level of positivity. Now, keep this in mind as we go through the next one. This was, again, as we do with all these studies, we just clump all these four diseases together. The intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma here represented almost half of the patients in the French population. And then the N-plus disease, so the lymph node positive patients, which if we want to believe the meta-analysis was the one that would benefit, was the group of patients that would benefit the most, was actually a small number, a small percent, 37.2. And the R1 resection was actually pretty small for this type of disease, but that probably is reflected by the fact that there were mostly intrahepatic cholangiocarcinomas, and that was 13.8%. This was tough, of course, only 33% completed all cycles. The BILCAP study was actually from the UK, a little larger study. It essentially just looked at a simple capecitabine versus observation randomized. There was a poor protocol analysis and intent to treat analysis. Mind you that the poor protocol analysis essentially was predefined, so this was not a post hoc analysis. It was statistically powered, and it was patients who actually were able to take the capecitabine versus observation. And then looking at the observation capecitabine arm, now the intrahepatic cholangiocarcinomas were underrepresented compared to the French study, 18 and 19%. And the R1 resection rate was actually relatively higher. Remember, it was about 13% on the French study. It's about 38 here. And the same, the N1 status was higher. And these are the patients that tend to benefit mostly from adjuvant therapy. Again, if we want to go back and think about the meta-analysis. And this study came back clinically meaningfully positive and ended up essentially establishing our standard with capecitabine versus observation. And so capecitabine as a single agent could be declared now a standard based on a phase 3 study. So that's the only phase 3 study we have on hand that has a positive data that guides us in terms of what makes sense in this group of patients. All right, so we and I borrowed this from one of my colleagues from Florida, Kabir Modi. So we talked about the pros, because we talked about the cons. How about the pawns and the crows? And that would be actually radiation therapy. So what do we know about radiation therapy? When you look at hilar cholangiocarcinoma versus gallbladder, which you know are the areas that where we think maybe radiation has a role, there are different patterns of recurrence. For gallbladder, it's primarily distance. For hilar, it's primarily local regional, and that's important to keep in mind. And again, that doesn't mean that local control itself is going to make a difference in terms of survival, but just we need to understand these recurrence patterns when we make a case. We know this study. This is the SWOG 0809 run by Ben Joseph. It was a question of adjuvant gemcitabine and capecitabine followed by chemotherapy and radiation in extrahepatic cholangio and gallbladder cancer. Now remember, this was advertised as a radiation study. It wasn't. It was a chemotherapy followed by chemotherapy and radiation. And it did reach its primary endpoint, but it didn't address whether there's truly a role for radiation or not in this group of patients. You can argue that most of the benefit came from the gemcitabine and capecitabine. You can't argue against that. You just have to ask the question in a randomized setting. So we established that capecitabine is the standard for the adjuvant treatment of patients in curatively resected biliary tract cancer. And since I was assigned the task to make the case for gemcitabine and capecitabine, I'm going to try to do that. Can we enhance its benefits? So in biliary tract cancer, capecitabine, and I'm going to do it like I used to do it when I was in, 10 years old, learning how to do math and physics. So capecitabine is better than observation. We have that. Gemcitabine, oxaliplatin, this kind of looks like observation, but you can argue it was borderline positive. Maybe that gemcitabine is adding something. Gemcitabine and capecitabine, followed by capecitabine and radiation, was positive based on the Ben Joseph study. Although it's a lower level of evidence, it's a phase 2 study, but it does say, it does tell us at least that capecitabine and maybe gemcitabine added to it makes sense. There's a study from Japan, actually, with gemcitabine and S1 that looked better than gemcitabine, a retrospective analysis, but it was a large cohort. So I say it's an even lower level of evidence, but it still tells us maybe adding a gemcitabine to fluoropyrimidine makes sense. And then I go to pancreas, which is a closely related cancer, and gemcitabine is better than observation. Gemcitabine is equivalent to 5-FU by aspect 3. And as Dr. O'Reilly told us, gemcitabine and capecitabine, and showed us, that is better than gemcitabine a la SPAC4. So my conclusion is optimal adjuvant therapy for biliary cancer is at least capecitabine. You can't argue with capecitabine, but I would argue that gemcitabine and capecitabine could be actually considered a standard favored over capecitabine alone, pending a confirmatory study planned by the SWOG proposal. These are some of the ongoing studies right now. And in terms of chemoradiotherapy, I think more research needs to be done. There may be very limited applications for radiation. We still have to understand where the role of radiation and local control is. Perhaps best addressed moving radiation to the neoadjuvant setting, as in pancreas. Perhaps the adjuvant setting is not the right place for it. But I think it's about time just for us to move away from this whole discussions about is it chemo, is it radiation. I mean, biliary tract cancer is unique in that space, at least, in the pancreas and biliary and liver space, where actually there is a genetic landscape that has been defined that looks very differently in gallbladder, in extrahepatic and intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma. We have agents actually being looked at in the advanced setting, and I think it's time to bring those perhaps to the earlier stages and perhaps start asking more biologic questions. Thank you.